Okay, great. Everybody, and welcome to the Thursday, April the 21st, Tuesday, April the 21st session in our series on entrepreneurship in Asian high-tech industries. And I'm really excited today that we can actually be live in Tokyo, Japan, and talk from one of the new incubators in Tokyo, Japan, which is really a venture community. And yeah, this is great. I have a whole lot of people lined up here. We're at Venture Generation, which is in downtown Tokyo, and it is 8:18 in the morning here. I'm kind of panning around the room. You can see that it is a classic sort of, you know, incubator-type co-location setting. There's also a conference room one floor up and so forth. So this is Kohei Hayashi, who is with J-Seed, an angel kind of investment group here. Next to Kohei is Ken Nagao, and Ken is with Hyperion, right? Which is kind of the physical side of the incubator here. Next to Ken is Tim Romero, who is well known for blogging, or I'm sorry, the podcast Disrupt Japan. Tim is going to be giving us some comments this morning. Tim's also a serial entrepreneur. Next to Tim is Jeff Char. Jeff, Jeff is a serial entrepreneur who really was responsible for coming up with, you know, J-Seed Ventures, and now with Venture Generation. And kind of behind me, I will not pan back over, are VB and Roxanne, who are interning here, one from Oslo, Norway, and one from Malaysia by way of Waseda University. So welcome, everybody. Glad that you could all be here.
Yeah, thanks a lot for inviting me here. I'm really delighted to participate. I've been in Japan over two decades. I've started four companies here. What I'd like to do in the next 5 to 10 minutes is provide a bit of information about how change occurs in Japan, how disruptive technology takes root, and hopefully, by the end of this talk, destroy one of the most pervasive and damaging myths about change in Japan. Does that sound good? Next slide. So, before we get to that, I think it's a fair question on why you should even listen to me on this subject. So let's just take a minute and run through it. Next slide. So I mentioned I've been here for two decades. I've started four different companies here, two exits, two bankruptcies, batting 500. Not too bad. I've been involved with more projects than I can count. I'm now working with Sunbridge on market entry for B2B technology companies, bringing them into Japan, and with Women's Startup Lab to establish a branch here in Tokyo. And I think that's going to be, women entrepreneurship is going to be a tremendous force for good in Japan.
Let me interrupt you and say that we had Adi speak in our series last fall.
Oh, fantastic.
Adi Hurier.
She's doing amazing
right.
Stuff. And I also run the Disrupting Japan podcast, where we sit down and we talk with startup founders about startups in Japan, about the Japanese economy, about what they see for the future of Japan. And these interviews are in English, so there's alcohol involved in more than a few of them. It's amazing how well people speak English after a couple of beers. But the thing is, when you sit down and you talk to these people, the guys that are actually building companies and making sales, you get a completely different perspective on the Japanese economy and on the future of Japan, and about the willingness for people to accept innovation than you do when you speak to the big industry groups and the politicians who listen to them. And there's a really good reason for that, but we're getting a bit ahead of our story. We'll get back to that. It's an important point. So before we go on, before we get back to that, let's bust a few myths. So next slide. So if you have been in Japan for more than, say, 24 hours, someone will have told you that Japan changes slowly. It is something that's repeated from politicians at the highest level of government down to elementary school students. and it's complete bullshit. It's an excuse that's used by people who are either too timid or who lack the power to make the changes that need to be made. And if we achieve nothing else by the end of this talk, I hope we'll all agree to stop repeating this errant nonsense. And you'll see it for what it is in just a minute. So to prove this, first we need to step back into the mid-1800s for a second. Next slide. So at that time, Japan ended centuries of isolation when Commodore Perry sailed into Yokohama Harbor with four large American warships that looked absolutely nothing like the slide you see in front of you. But the Japanese leadership saw the writing on the wall. They knew that they needed to change. And the Meiji Restoration that followed, Japan changed every aspect of their society. The educational system, the government, the legal system, even the Japanese language. There was no unified Japanese language before this time. The canon of Japanese history that today is universally accepted as true was largely agreed upon and put together during this time. And so basically starting from nothing, within 40 years, Japan managed to defeat Russia in the Russo-Japanese War. Now, this is not to praise Japanese militarism by any stretch of the imagination. That was a path Japan went down, led to untold suffering throughout Asia. There's a lot of scars that still haven't healed because of that. No, my point is something much simpler, that from the beginning of the Meiji Restoration in 1868 to the Treaty of Portsmouth in 1905, so that's less than 40 years. So in about the same time it takes most people to pay off their mortgages, Japan went from a country that was literally hundreds of years behind the times, technologically, diplomatically, industrially, into a nation capable of defeating one of the world's great powers. This was unprecedented. Nothing like this had ever happened before, but something much like it would happen again. Next slide. Can I get the next slide, please? Nope. Other way. Nope. Back. You had it. There you go.
This is Shinjuku with Mount Fuji behind it. Yeah.
So Japan's defeat in the war was total, absolute. And if you go back and you look at what some of the economists working with the occupation forces were saying, some of them said that Japan could never recover. The damage was too extensive. They lacked the ability to understand the modern dynamics involved in a democratic, industrialized country. Well, we all know how that turned out. So Japan set about changing yourself from a military industrial focused economy into a consumer focused democracy. And again, in less than 40 years, she went from a country that was an economic basket case, one with practically no functioning infrastructure, into the second largest economy on the planet. All right? Japan is not a country that has trouble with change. In fact, no country now or in the history of the world has ever been able to change so quickly, so completely, and so often as Japan. So let's all, for the love of God, stop repeating this nonsense that Japan changes slowly. Japan changes very quickly. Next slide. But this time, something really is different. So in Japan's past two economic miracles, they were top-down affairs. They were centrally planned. They were executed through a rigid and extremely efficient hierarchy. But innovation, particularly disruptive innovation, doesn't work top-down. It's almost by definition a bottom-up process. And Japan has never been very good at bottom-up. But this, too, is starting to change. And there's two main drivers for it. First, and most important, it gets back to this generation of entrepreneurs. This generation of entrepreneurs is very different from the predecessors in one very important way. So if you look at the great entrepreneurial companies of the industrial age, of the 60s, the 70s, the Hondas, the Sonys, Now, these were companies who would compete aggressively and were highly disruptive overseas, but domestically, they played by the rules. They accepted the administrative guidance. They were careful not to engage in what government officials here like to call excessive competition. And the great internet companies, the Rakutens, Mixi, Greed, DNA. Now, these companies weren't going head-to-head with Fujitsu and NEC. They were competing with other startups. They were fighting over territory, new territory, that technological innovation had suddenly opened up. But this generation of entrepreneurs, if you talk to them, a lot of them will point to a large Japanese company that they view as a competitor. And they'll tell you, privately, of course. Publicly, you know, harmony must be maintained. But privately, they'll tell you, yeah, those guys, they can't do what we do. Even if they understood it, they couldn't execute on it. So maybe they'll buy us in a couple of years. Maybe we'll buy them in 10 years. Or maybe they'll go out of business in 20 years. Makes no difference to me. And while many older Japanese are kind of horrified at this level of aggression and competitiveness, this willingness to challenge the status quo, this willingness to disrupt, is precisely what is needed for change to happen from within Japan, rather than being imposed from outside. And it's already gaining traction. Now, the second thing that's happening that's really important is up until about 15 years ago, innovation, particularly the creation of startups, was seen as some crazy voodoo-like process of utter chaos and creativity. And sometimes it does feel like that, I'll grant you. But thanks to the work of people like Steve Blank, Clayton Christensen, the Business Model Canvas, innovation and creation of startups is becoming a repeatable, measurable system. And the changes I've seen only in the last 5 years in terms of the quality of startup ideas, the quality of execution here in Japan, the progress in the last 5 years has been astounding. And I think a lot of it is due to the fact that there are now accepted processes for that execution. Now, I have absolutely no doubt that 30 years from now, Japan is going to be one of the global leaders, if not the global engine of technological innovation and disruptive technologies. Now, I'm not naive. I realize how absurd that claim sounds right now. It sounds every bit as absurd as someone in 1950 saying Japan would one day become a great economic power. It sounds every bit as absurd as someone in 1880 saying that Japan would someday become a great industrial and military power. But all of those things came to be. And I think now we know, we can understand the reason why. It's because Japan changes very, very quickly. Now, I hope this at least provides a little bit of fodder for questions and discussions. Next slide. Please feel free to not only ask me questions during the discussion period, but get in touch with me on Facebook, Twitter, listen to Disrupting Japan. I'm easy to find. So thanks a lot for the time and thanks for listening.
Thanks, Tim. We'll involve you in the discussion too. I do want to put a plug in for your podcast, Disrupt Japan. Some great interviews with really interesting people in this. And it really is what's going on in Japan right now.
Thanks.
I'd like to move the camera around. Don't hide behind that too much, Jeff, and ask Jeff Char. So, Jeff, what Tim says, why don't you pick it up from there? He gave us a great kind of introduction. Tell us a little bit about how you got involved, your background, and also what's happening with J-Seed and Venture Generation.
Okay. First of all, I want to thank especially Kohei, who my partner here. I've never seen him before 9 o'clock in the morning. It's pretty amazing that he got up to meet
you guys.
And Ken as well. So, I'd like to pick a fight with Tim after this, but first things first, I'm Jeff. I'm from the U.S. originally. I've spent half my life here in Japan. I went to school here. Back to the U.S. for grad school, and worked in Silicon Valley for several years as a lawyer. Started my first startup company in Silicon Valley network security company, built it and sold it to Lucent back in 1998, and have been starting companies ever since then. Moved back to Japan in 2000 when I set up JC Ventures as a platform for starting new companies. Ken and I started Venture Generation about 3 years ago, I think it is. Along with Tim's theory, we did it pretty quickly. I think we met around Christmas, and the doors were open around February, end of February. And we officially launched in April. So that was pretty quick. Koi has been with me for several years. We worked on a prior startup together. And then after he went off and did something else, we got back together and are working together again on some new ventures.
So tell a little bit about JSeed.
Sure. So JSeed, well, the short version is that after starting three companies in a row and selling them, my wife told me I wasn't allowed to start any more companies. So I set up JSeed as my last company, except that being a lawyer, I found a loophole. And JSeed's business is to start new companies.
Okay.
So that's kind of how it's run. I try not to be the CEO.
Where do you get the eggs for the companies? How do you find people who want to start a company?
Pretty easy. They just kind of go together. Yeah, they find me or I find them. It's just a matter of talking with lots of people.
Okay, because one of the things I want to do as we get into this is to ask, well, okay, why does the Japanese ecosystem have such a bad reputation?
I'll let Tim take that. The reason we invited Tim here today is because he's such a great speaker and he's so knowledgeable. But just to get him going here, let me pick a fight. So I think that Japan changes very slowly until it changes. And when it changes quickly. But I would say that until it starts changing, years can go by, and I was kind of reminiscing about this yesterday when I had lunch with somebody, and we talked about a project, and I thought, wow, you know, I considered that project 11 years ago, and I went back and sent the presentation I had made 11 years ago to the guy, as well as to our interns, and said, take a look at this. I'm thinking about dusting it off and doing it again, because I think the time's finally come where this is going to change and this new venture would become viable. But until then, you know, like I said, I put together a whole proposal 11 years ago and shelved it because nothing changed during that interim.
Okay. I don't think do you want to?
No, go ahead.
Okay, I would say I don't think we disagree too much on that point. I'd say that Japan, people hear the process deciding to change can take a long time. Talking to people, deciding that change is a good idea, that can take a while. Once the decision is made, the change comes very quickly.
Yeah.
Actually, if I can jump in with my perspective on this, Japan always looks to me like a glacier about to calve. Because you see all these little cracks and you think nothing is going to happen, and then suddenly, boom, this whole wall of ice falls off. And I wonder what the signs are for the impending change.
Wow. It's hard to point to on a macro scale. So I guess I can give just a couple of different things that I've seen. I think that... So a lot of attention's been given to, like, there's been some big government programs to support entrepreneurship and provide funding for them. And by any objective measure, in terms of return on investment, in terms of a lot of the investment these companies or these government funds are making, they have not been a wild success. But the government's been using kind of the bully pulpit to, just by the government out there saying that startups are important to the future. When Prime Minister Abe shows up at startup events and talks about it, it legitimizes startups. And one of the challenges that, you know, I've had and everyone has had in the last 20-some-odd years has been that startups were seen as a second-class citizen. And that's changed quite a bit. Large companies are much more willing to work with startups now. There are whole organizations devoted to helping startups sell to large companies. The M&A activity is picking up slowly, but it is picking up. So it's nothing I can point to on a macro scale that in any way compares to what's going on in San Francisco.
Okay.
But all of the trends are moving in the right direction.
So in some ways, Tim, you and Jeff are sort of like the black ships back during the, you know, before the Meiji Restoration. I want to turn the microphone over, if I can not make it fall over, and ask Ken and Kohei, how did you get involved in this? What's your background? As Japanese, you know, young Japanese people, what made you take the path that you've taken?
So, okay, let me...
So this is Kohei.
Yeah, hi. So let me take a stab at it. I studied in the States. I went to university in Wisconsin, then came back to Japan, worked for a couple of years, then went back to the States for grad school, MBA at Babson College, then came back to Japan, finally started my own first company. I guess the reason was, it could be somewhat related to the fact that I was educated in the States, you know, like, it's pretty, you know, normal, you know, for, you know, American, you know, Americans to start a company or, you know, pursue, you know, your own.
But I got to call you on this. You went to Babson, right?
Yes.
Babson's very, you know, well-known in entrepreneurship studies.
Yeah, so but
even, were you already interested before you went?
Yeah, actually, that's the reason I picked up the school. Yeah. I guess back in college, I got involved in like a lot of the music scene in Wisconsin, and got into local student radio show and stuff, and organized events, and so like. It was like industry specific, but you know, I always wanted to start my own like music company or like, you know, music label. Like, you know, as you know, the record industry collapsed in the past 10 years, but still, you know, that was always, you know, in my head. You know.
Yeah.
So actually, I was, you know, preparing, you know, or looking for right time. You know.
So do you think that, do you agree with Tim's point that it used to be kind of entrepreneurs were second-class citizens, and now they're really being treated like kind of very, you know, the word I've heard is unicorns, right? Very rare and hard to find and maybe valuable.
It was true that, you know, like when I first started my own company, but that was like back in 2007 or 2008, it was really hard to find fellow entrepreneurs. Of course, you know, there's always been, you know, a group of people who are interested in startup, you know, way, you know, back in like 80s or 90s. But, you know, for me, like, you know, it was really hard to find, you know, like-minded people, you know, who could, you know, share, you know, the pain and like agony of starting a company.
So, Kohei, you and Jeff are in the process of starting companies now, right?
Yes.
That's what JC does.
Yes. So at JC, as Jeff explained, you know, we don't just, you know, start a company right away. You know, we start eight projects, you know, actually multiple projects in parallel. We just come, you know, one of us just come up and is like, hey, would it be nice to, you know, do something like this? Then, okay, you know, let's take a look at, you know, possibility and maybe create a minimum viable product and, you know, try it out and see if it works. And most of the time, actually, the project doesn't work, you know, maybe like we misunderstood the demand or customer needs. But, you know, on a rare occasion, you know, the project becomes successful.
Yeah.
Then when it gets traction, we spin off a company as you know, a proper a corporate entity, a new startup, then look for funding from outside investors.
Okay. So one of the really important things about this whole ecosystem that makes it possible to start companies is space, right? And Ken, you're with Hyperion, which is really kind of the real estate angle on this, right?
More of the services.
Yeah.
I want to say good morning, but I know it's evening over there. My name is Ken, and we provide a lot of the facilities. So.
Yeah.
Facility services, so the space and the expertise that comes along with that. To answer your question, how do I get involved?
So you're a partner in Venture Generation, right?
That's correct.
Okay. So the Venture Generation is this co-location space that we're in. JSEED was kind of the investment / facilitator company to really grow this. What's the name for that? What do you call that?
We don't know yet.
Okay.
Yeah, I just explain what we do.
Yeah, good. So,
Kent,
go for it.
Like Jeff said, about 3 years ago, he gave me this pitch about an idea, which was essentially a community for startups, run by startups. And back then, starting up a company in Japan, as is now, was a relatively difficult process. So he figured that if there was a space where entrepreneurs can teach each other their successes as well as their failures, and to be able to share that experience, that would be part of the ecosystem that's necessary for Japan to actually build better startups.
Yeah.
Now
you all have really got a very interesting kind of ecosystem going here. This is a killer location. You're within walking distance of Ginza in Tokyo, Tokyo Station. You can get anywhere here. And that's great because one of the things that company people always have to do is go around and make calls on potential clients and potential partners, and that's one of the most critical aspects. Also, I think that if I can kind of go back to sort of the big picture, I was really impressed with the mentor network that you created behind this. That's absolutely remarkable. I mean, the name that I remember off the top of my head is Mikitani-san. Right? The founder of Docuton is one of the mentors for companies here, correct?
He's not officially a mentor.
So. Oh, okay. Sorry. I remember seeing his name in the news article somewhere. Okay. But tell us a little bit more about how this is growing. You started Venture Generation when?
This is February of 2012.
Okay. And so are you having trouble finding companies?
That's a good question. I think better question is, do we have any trouble finding companies that pass Jeff's rigid application process? And
okay.
What I mean by that
no,
is
that's
I
an think, important point.
I think a lot of young entrepreneurs in Japan see Silicon Valley, they see the how would you describe that?
Just the glamour.
The glamour.
So people have watched The Social Network and think, oh, I want to do that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so they have a little bit of delusion that comes with it, and maybe that's necessary. But at the same token, if you're going to start up a business anywhere in the world, really, you need to have a functioning business model, at least, and some ideas as to how that business is going to generate, or let me take that back, some ideas as to how that idea is going to generate revenue. A lot of people come up with ideas that I think are interesting, but it may be interesting in terms of just being a hobby and not being an actual business.
Now, this is an interesting point because one of the things that I'm hearing from various people, you used to hear all of these stories about how there's no venture capital in Japan or there's absolutely insufficient venture capital in Japan. And, okay, the amount of venture capital has ticked up quite a bit. There's been an uptick for the last couple of years, but now what I'm hearing is that the money is looking for really good plans and they're not able to find the plans that are of the quality that they want.
I'd say there is some truth to that, but I think another part of it is that by and large, venture capitalists are trend followers and they're scared, no offense. Present company excluded, obviously. But no, a lot of the money is poured into these funds that don't have experience investing in venture companies. And so some of the biggest funds won't even invest in Japan.
They're going to Silicon Valley. But again, it is starting to change. There's still a bit of a Series A crunch here. It's very easy to raise seed money right
now.
Follow-on funding is harder to find, but I think the reason is that most of the companies that are getting seed funding, to Ken's point, really they can't survive on their own. They can't like hatch from the incubator and fly. So there is not really enough solid deal flow, companies to support solid deal flow in Series A now. But the money is there.
Yeah, I agree with Tim. I think the money exists here. We have pretty deep pockets here. It's more an issue of allocation. So I think there's probably two things there. One is as Tim mentioned, there are just not enough good startups here that would justify investing in them. Secondly, venture capital as an industry here in Japan is pretty much captive under, and these are venture capital subsidiaries of large financial institutions, which is very different from the structure in the States. I'd say it's more like venture capital was in the U.S. back in the 50s or 60s, where it was mostly out of New York, and subsidiaries, or, you know, pockets of money that were controlled by financial institutions. Not like Silicon Valley type of VCs where typically the investor is an ex-entrepreneur who has started their own company and taken it public or sold it or both, and is, you know, using their own money in the first place, and has got a track record like that. So most of the so-called venture capitalists here in Japan are company employees, first and foremost. They were transferred by the personnel department to the venture capital subsidiary and given a business card that says venture capitalist on it. And you know, now all of a sudden they're supposed to be a venture capitalist.
Yeah.
So very different dynamics. Also, the risk and reward is different. If they fail to invest in a company that later goes public, their boss asks them why they didn't invest. And if they put too much money into a company that fails, they're asked why they picked that company. So there's a strong incentive for them to invest small amounts in many companies and not put a lot of money into any single company. And therefore, it's a lot easier to raise a seed round than it is to raise a Series A or Series B round.
So in some ways, that sort of lack of sophistication may open up opportunities for non-Japanese venture capital to come in. Are you seeing many kind of new plays from outside Japan?
I've seen a lot of, there's a lot of foreign angel investment. 500 startups has been very, very visible. There's been a lot of Japanese who have, a lot of foreign funds that have like brought people from Japan to Silicon Valley. But I'd say we're really just in the beginning of foreign investment on seed. And I think the reason is you really have to be on the ground here to know what's, you know, what you should invest in. And very few U.S. and European firms have made that commitment to Japan just yet.
Well, actually, going back even further than the dot-com bubble, there were a couple of U.S. venture capital funds that came into the Japanese market, and it was a bloodbath. They came in, they invested, I think upward of 100 million U.S. in total, and the returns were negative. I mean, they didn't even get their money back. So it was pretty bad back then. And at the time, they came in with a lot of money, and they placed big bets on a very immature group of entrepreneurs, and they lost most of that money as a result. So I think the result would be very different today because the bench, the depth of the entrepreneurial bench here is a lot bigger, it's a lot broader, it's a lot deeper. And so somebody coming in now with venture capital funds could do more damage, I think.
So what do you think is the best way that the whole ecosystem for entrepreneurship in Japan, what's the best thing that can be done? Do you think that the idea of starting a company here and then growing it in Silicon Valley is attractive? Do you think that
is this an education problem, or is it that young Japanese people are not allowed to think for themselves by the system? What can we do at this point that would kind of make it more exciting?
I think the most important thing is, and it's already starting to happen, it's been in defining the entrepreneurial process as a process. So it's starting to change the way the Japanese perceive risk and entrepreneurship and what they perceive as failure. So following a process and viewing the startup as an experiment, and that if it doesn't work out, it's not necessarily a failure. That idea is strongly gaining hold within the entrepreneurial community already. It's spreading through the larger ones, the larger companies. And I think that's perhaps the most important thing. So there's no shortage of creative talent and creative ideas in Japan, whether you're talking about startups or music or art or whatever. The problem has always been how to let those ideas bubble up. And I think systematizing, you know, making startups a verifiable process is perhaps the most important development for Japanese entrepreneurship.
I'd jump in and just say that I think there's one link that I won't say it's missing, but it's underdeveloped to kind of close the loop on the ecosystem. And that to me is M&A. Yeah. Viable exits for startups. And I think, you know, when I was working in Silicon Valley, M&A was really gaining in prevalence. You know, in the old days, it used to be that, you know, when the stock market was up, you'd have a lot of IPOs. And when the stock market was down, you'd have a lot of M&A. And I think nowadays, if you look at Silicon Valley, it's you have M&A throughout. And yeah, when the market's down, you have more M&A. But even when it's up, you have a lot of M&A.
Yeah.
And only a few companies are going public. And that's probably because the cost of going public and whatnot has increased. But in Japan, we still, you know, just the absolute number of either IPOs or M&A is quite small. As that increases, and it is increasing, but as that increases, especially M&A, because M&A usually happens earlier, and the investors get all their money back, versus an IPO where oftentimes you're still not liquid. So for more M&A happening in this market, I think would return cash back to investors sooner. It would also provide the entrepreneurs with cash, security for their families. And it really changes the whole ecosystem, I think, in the sense that it accelerates, kind of catalyzes the system. And often, for example, myself, when I sell a company, I rarely go over to the buyer. Or if I do, I don't stick around very long. So I think if there were more M&As happening here in Japan, you would see teams leaving and starting new companies. They could go back to their previous investors who made money on the last deal, would be much more inclined to investing in the next deal. Their friends and colleagues from the past venture would also probably chip in and invest. So I think that's really the missing link at this point. And as that occurs and as it happens more frequently, the whole system then would, I think, accelerate and growth and development would accelerate.
One thing I just want to add on top of this, there is, and to plug the podcast once again, next Tuesday, the show that's being released on Disrupting Japan introduces a new and kind of uniquely Japanese alternative to M&A. So a company called Quantum has been working with very large Japanese companies on, it's kind of sponsored entrepreneurship where it's a series of ongoing investments where the end result is basically M&A. But it's a very long-term, low-risk, incremental approach that he thinks will really gain traction in Japan and perhaps the rest of Asia. So there might be like even alternatives and new structures that we're going to see here that we haven't really seen take hold in the US.
So when you say it's an alternative to M&A, does this mean that the founders cash out or partially cash out?
I guess the end result is the same, but the process is different. It's not, you know, it's the traditional way is you grow a company, you independently prove in the marketplace that what you're doing is valid and can add value, and then you go out and shop yourself. And what this is, it's more strategic partnerships at a very early stage that long-term investment is agreed to, but the end result's the same.
Okay, because in some ways that sounds a lot like the old traditional system inside a keidetsu, where a new business line would be an independent company, but often the company would stay independent inside the keidetsu and basically never be able to go beyond a niche in the supply chain.
And the big difference now is that that boundary is not there. If the sponsoring company doesn't want to acquire them, they can go take it somewhere else. So
okay.
They maintain true independence.
Wow. I'll look forward to that. Ken, Kohei, do you, anything about that? What would you recommend for the system?
For me, it's mostly about education and understanding the risk involved with startups, especially in Japan. You know, a lot of people think, you know, starting a company is really risky, and like you have to, you know, risk your like whole, you know, asset or like, you know, your whole life, you know, to it. Like, that was because like before, you know, starting a company meant borrowing money from banks, and like if your company fails, you know, you were like, you know, you have to like personally guarantee to pay back the loan. So like a lot of people got into trouble, you know, paying back money even after their company collapsed. So, but you know, as you guys know, you know, in startup, you know, you can do like equity financing, and our younger generation of like especially ID startup people are, you know, starting to understand, you know, that process, and that, you know, even if, you know, they fail the first time, you know they can try like multiple times. Mm-hmm. So like educating like potential entrepreneurs about the process and the concept of debt versus like equity financing it's gonna, you know, create a huge impact, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting to me to find this community being so active, and it's really not well known outside, really outside the community even.
It's true.
In Japan, you hear, you know, there are no entrepreneurs and all of this.
Yeah, absolutely.
Ken, what about you? What would you want to recommend?
I think the thing about Japanese entrepreneurs is that they face a market where the level of service that the customers expect is nothing that you see anywhere else in the world. And you see that everywhere from just being in a restaurant to any large enterprise level B2B businesses. So the level of service that your customers expect is not far above what a US customer expects. So I think what needs to happen right now are for Japanese entrepreneurs to really create vibrant working business models. Once they establish a model that works in Japan, I think it's very easy to export that globally. But at that point, you do need specialist technocrats that are going to help you expand globally. Maybe that's a skill that needs to, that more entrepreneurs need to work on.
Okay. Questions from the floor.
Yeah. So I'm wondering how many of these incubators are there in Japan, and what has been their success so far? Because my impression here in the U.S. is there's a lot of the incubators, but probably only Y Combinator is the most successful one.
That's a great question.
Just to kind of cop out on that, we don't think of ourselves as an incubator. We're not. We don't take equity stakes in the companies. Some of the companies in our space are started by us, and we own equity in them. But by and large, it's just a community of startups. So, you know, as the saying goes, misery loves company. Having said that, there's probably three main incubators here in Japan that I can think of. I mean, there's a whole bunch of government ones, but we'll leave them out because they're all dead and useless. But I think probably the three main ones,
Digital Garage.
Yeah, Digital Garage is Open Network Labs, Movida,
Movida Cyber Agent still has theirs going, right?
Okay, Cyber Agent, and maybe Samurai?
Samurai. Yeah,
okay, so maybe four or five. You know, I think even in the U.S., you've got a big disparity between Y Combinator and maybe many of the others. But some of the others are also pretty good, I think, Techstars and whatnot. So all I'll say is that it's better to have these guys in the community and helping out the ecosystem and even the companies that go through them, if they fail, it's more experience and it broadens and deepens the bench. So I think it's all good. If I was a startup or if I was starting my new company today, I probably wouldn't go to any of them. But I think the fact that they exist and that they're alternatives is a good thing.
Okay. That was a great question. Next question, please.
So I'm kind of wondering about the questions the statements you guys were making about seed funding over there, and the kind of funding that is available. Is there any kind of program where there's like a 2+1 kind of thing, where if you pull in two guys from the companies there in Japan, the different kinds of banks there, that then you could network with somebody in America to get the third leg of the funding? So that then you could have that dynamic where you could have that company started here and then eventually move to America that you're talking about.
I don't know of any kind of formalized program that way. I know a lot of companies who have raised money in America, either had the entire round filled in America or are filled, you know, partially in Japan, partially in the U.S. But I don't think there's any type of program.
Yeah, let me go back and pick a fight. I don't think it's a good idea for most of the startups here in Japan to go to the U.S. And I say that because I think right now a lot of startups, a lot of entrepreneurs are enamored by, you know, TechCrunch and whatnot, and read too much of the press, and that how much money you raise determines how good a company you are, and vice versa. I think that's bullshit. I think the best reason to go to the U.S. would be because your customers are there and you're selling a product or service that they want and need. And actually, that's the only reason I would go to the U.S.
Yeah.
To go there to raise money just for the sake of raising money because the deep pockets are there, just to me is a waste of time. And many of the Japanese entrepreneurs who have tried to do that have failed because, number one, they don't speak English. Number two, they don't have the network there. So, you know, trying to hire people to join you, you're trying to hire the best engineers or marketing people, and, you know, those people have other alternatives. You know, they could go to join another hot startup, or they could go to Facebook or wherever. Why should they join you? And, you know, Tanaka-san, you don't even speak English. Not to be harsh, well, I usually am, but I think most of those companies should not waste time trying to go to the U.S. Having said that, there's some really good companies that have done that, gone to the U.S., but in most of those cases, the founders had some connection with the U.S. already. Either they were, you know, they're foreigners that were in Japan and just went back to the States, or they had time at school there. They had networks, they had the ability to build networks, and raising money was just one aspect, and they were selling to a crowd that was in the U.S.
If I can follow up on this question, because one other reason that I hear for startup companies to come to Silicon Valley especially is to get early market validation. It is hard to sell into a big company. Ken, you are saying how hard the expectations of customers are extremely high here. And so a lot of times it looks like the startup company really doesn't have good market access. What do you think on this one?
I'll jump all over this one. The early market validation, what I think they mean when they say that, and this is true. So if they're trying to raise funds in Japan, and this goes back to VCs being cowards, present company excluded. If you're trying to raise funds in Japan, having a well-known US VC investing in you will help you do it really, immensely, yeah. But it won't give you customer validation. It'll give you VC validation. I think, Jeff, your point was excellent. You want to be close to your customers, full stop. You know, wherever your customers are, that's where you want to be. And validation in the market is sales. It
yeah.
is selling real product to real customers. And if you can do that, you're validated. And there are enough VCs who aren't just blind trend followers that they will invest in you. And then the trend followers will follow along and put more money in. So I agree completely. It's not...
But Jeff, now you've started companies here and you've started companies in the U.S.
Yeah.
Getting the first customer, what's the process? Is it
well,
you know?
I'll tell you that my very first company was network security and my very first customer was Pacific Bell. And I can tell you, getting Pac Bell as your first customer, mm-hmm. it was no easy task. And so I don't think it's that different from here in Japan.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Great. Thanks for your question. That was a great one.
So this is more just a personal question for Tim, but I was doing some kind of web stalking and saw that you did undergrad at UVA physics. And I'm just curious, you know, like, how did you end up in Japan and why Japan for companies?
We're going to keep this answer short. The long one is very long. I came to Japan as a professional musician. A Japanese record company brought me here. And I had the hair down to here, and it was big 80s hair. my music career was short, even by Japanese standards. And ended up founding companies. I've been programming since I was 11. So founded a company, then, you know, rinse, wash, repeat. But fortunately, this was all, like, pre-internet, pre-YouTube, so I have all the evidence safely under control.
But yet you've decided to stay here.
It is. It's not something I ever... I've never planned on staying more than a couple of years, but every time, this is 22 years ago, but every time I think of going back or moving to the States, something more interesting comes up. And in fact, I had a job offer in Silicon Valley 2 months ago, and I gave it some thought, but I honestly think that in the next 5 years, I mean, I love San Francisco a lot, but I think the next 5 years, Japan is going to be more interesting than San Francisco in the next five. So I'm here for another five.
Okay, I'm going to get into deep water here because I think that, you know, you talk about the rapid change in Japan, and now the country that people are associating with rapid change is China. Do you think if you were an American, should you be more interested in opportunities in Japan or... Forget Japan. China's where it's at.
Depends what you're selling.
Yeah, it really depends. I think it's going to be a personal choice for everyone. I choose, like Tim, to be here in Japan. Number one, I like living here. It's safe as long as you don't live next to a nuclear reactor. the food's great. You know, you can't eat the food here, and I travel a lot. So whenever I come back to Japan, I always appreciate that things work here. So, you know, I go to China a lot, and frankly, I like breathing air sometimes. So living here is just a better alternative for me.
Okay, thanks. Let's go to another question.
Do you think there's opportunity for other kinds of companies besides tech companies, for example, food company?
You know, like one of the JC projects, it hasn't become a company yet, but we've been looking into this shrimp factory. You know, like Japanese people love shrimp, and we are the second largest consumer of shrimp after US. But recently, the yen's, you know, going cheaper and cheaper, and the import price of seafood is getting more and more expensive. So one startup idea here was to start up a shrimp factory using a technology developed by one of the top Japanese universities, much like plant factories you see someplace else. So that's kind of like, you know, interesting project,
yeah.
Other than like information technology.
So actually, it's great that this question came out, because people who are in the business of trying to grow companies, trying to be successful investors in startup companies, really care about something that's going to have a positive benefit that will be recognized with the metric of profit.
right? So, you know, I think that it's really good to remember that that's what's important to the investors. I do see a lot of really interesting technologies and things coming out of Japan. Anybody at the table, what are some really interesting things that you've seen in the last year or two?
Japan is like the world's top aging population. So we need a way to support elders and elderly care. And one of the trend is for robotics companies, you know, to support the care workers to, you know, they wear their robotics clothes, and it helps you to lift heavy objects.
Right.
The company who develops that technology just went public in Japan. So I think you'll see more of those companies focusing on elderly care and other things.
Okay, so elderly care is one area. Other areas from anybody?
Oh, wow, that's a really broad question. There's a lot going on. I'd say a couple of interesting companies I've seen recently that I haven't seen similar companies globally. There was a company at a pitch event I was judging at a couple of weeks ago that has a small wearable device that takes an ultrasound of your guts and gives you and this sounds silly, but it gives you a heads up about 5 minutes before you need to get to the bathroom, which, again,
elderly care,
it is a huge market. And it's about, yay big.
Yeah.
Put it there. And if it works as advertised, I think they're going to do incredibly well. There's another company, the president was on the podcast a while ago, called Wantedly, that has fundamentally changed the way recruiting works. Here in Japan, it's just, there's no resumes, there's no histories. It's just, I'm interested in these kind of projects. And then let's set up time to come for coffee. And it was odd when I first used it, but we hired some people out of there. And even now, Recruit, the largest recruiting company, are hiring staff using this service rather than their own. That says something.
That says something.
Yeah.
And they're expanding to Singapore, I believe, this year. So there is a lot of really unique, different tech and ideas coming out of Japan.
And again, I don't think it's all about tech. Most of my companies have been focused on technology, but I'm an investor and a former director on a company that has scaled up to over 1,000 employees, and it's not about technology. This company is about solving problems, and I think that's fundamentally what all of these companies are about. But the problem they're solving is training and job placement for people with disabilities. And this company has been very successful. It's grown wildly over the last few years, and will probably go public in the next couple of years.
So I was wondering about the point that the two gentlemen to your left there, my left, your right, I suppose, or I guess it's your left as well, about the education. So the point is, what's the perfect time to start educating people in entrepreneurship? Is it in middle school? Is it in high school? Is it in college? Is it all the time? Some of the time?
I don't know if you heard that. We got one comment, as soon as they can walk.
at JC, we've been trying to offer one week educational program during the summer to college students, and we teach about Steve Blank's method or Eric Ries and business model canvas, lean startups, and we put students into a group of five, and they have to come up with a viable business model, within a week, and that includes, going out to potential customers and, try to validate your ideas. So we've been trying that, and
So that's really experiential education.
Yeah.
And I do think that, you know, a lot of people, when they think education, all they think of is a teacher lecturing to a bunch of students sitting in a classroom. Right?
Yeah, that doesn't work.
No.
Yeah.
Not only does it not work, but I do think that you're starting to see more things happening.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of programs, especially at the college level, to bring people out into, you know, places where they meet people other than teachers.
Yeah. So the earlier the better, I think. But at the same time, you know, you're never too old to start a company, I don't think. So I think it's also important to educate, you know, people, you know, who are not typically considered like startup founders, people who are in like their like 50s or even in their like 60s, you know.
Yeah.
They have their own, like, you know, network, and you know, they have experience under their belt. You know, I know like one public company. It's an like, internet insurance company. One of the founders started the company for the first time after he retired after 60 years old. You know, so that kind of role models, you know, help a lot.
Yeah, it really does.
I'm not sure what's the right time or how early you should start teaching entrepreneurship, but I do know that right now in Japan, at the college level, there's tremendous interest from the students. I coach at Startup Weekend frequently, and they're packed mostly with college students. I'm also encouraged by the fact that about, on average, 1/4 to 1/3 of the participants are women. And it's the biggest shift, as you said, it's got to be away from, especially in Japan, where education has always been lectures, to processes that are really hands-on, go talk to customers, try to sell something. But from what I've seen, certainly at the university level and above, people are taking to it with no problems. They get it. They do it. So it's happening.
Yeah, and young people have a much more kind of social side of business attitude than they used to.
Yeah.
You know, this is a kind of socialization opportunity for a lot of young people now.
Actually, one other thing I've noticed that might be kind of interesting is that the further you get from Tokyo, the more entrepreneurial and more aggressive some of the students tend to be. So a lot of the events I've worked with in Tokyo, when it's, you know, Friday night, like, okay, now you got to go out and talk to people. There's a real, like, well, I just want to do a few more research, a little more research on Google here. By the time you get down to, like, Fukuoka, you know, it's like, okay, now it's time to, where'd they go? You know, they're out. They're talking to people. And I think that might be because, you know, like, even, you know, Silicon Valley didn't come to be in New York. San Francisco wasn't even the top 10 U.S. cities at that time. So maybe you do need to get a little bit of a distance from financial and political power before you can really get entrepreneurship and this kind of creative, aggressive, you know, creation going on.
Yeah, I think you're right, 100%. I'm going to kind of close off the session today with one last question for everybody. And I think the thing is really kind of going back to this, you know, here we are presenting this program to a Silicon Valley audience. Why? So, you know, Jeff, you said that a lot of the companies here should not try to go to the U.S., but what should Silicon Valley think about in regard to Japan? I mean, my sense is that Japan in general is sort of, you know, off the radar. And is there, you know, a compelling reason for Silicon Valley to pay more attention? And we'll, you know, close it up at the end of this.
So I think it really depends on what your company's doing, what product or service you're selling. But I would say that in many cases, it would be to your benefit to consider Japan or coming to Japan. It's a rich market. We have a large population, even if a quarter of them are over 65. We spend money on services. If you look at the amount of money that the people here pay for apps and whatnot on mobile devices, probably one of the highest in the world, if not the highest. You know, that we're willing to spend money on things that we want. So I think that's one really good aspect. The other one is, as I think Ken mentioned, it's a tough market. So if you can come in here and satisfy Japanese customers, you can pretty much satisfy anybody. You know, your service, the quality of your product or service is going to have to really improve in order to do well here. It's a challenge worth undertaking because it'll improve your product or service.
Okay. Tim?
I think that's an excellent point. But I'd like to have from a perspective of, like, say, a VC perspective. In any business, but particularly VC, there's two ways to make money. You can either be a trend follower or you can be a contrarian. And both ways make money. But if you want to be a trend follower and you actually do have access to deal flow in San Francisco, I mean real access, then absolutely San Francisco is the place to be. If you want to be a contrarian, then by definition, you have to be looking at things, looking at companies and places that all the trend followers are saying, no, there's nothing happening there. And right now, Japan is probably the perfect place to be a contrarian. There's enough things that are starting to happen here that it, and in fact, it is sort of attracting a lot of the contrarian interest. And I think in 5 years, it'll start attracting the trend follower interest. So it's important to pay attention.
Okay. Ken?
I would simply say that I think efficiency. So if you're from an entrepreneur's perspective and you want to see how efficient systems can be run, and maybe perhaps that's not the ecosystem, startup ecosystem right now, but if you want to see efficient businesses, you should at least take a look at Japan. I think nowhere else in the world does public infrastructure, for instance, work as efficiently as it does here in Japan. And nowhere else in the world does established businesses work efficiently. So if you want to take a real good case example of how efficient businesses can be, that would be one reason why you might want to take a deep look at that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Sure. So like, this is not like only for Japan, but like if you spend like enough time in like more than two countries, like you start to see the difference, or like, you know, what's lacking, you know, in that country compared to your own country, or vice versa, you know. But it, you know, maybe, you know, things that are given in the States, you know, don't exist yet in Japan, you know, that could create a huge opportunity, you know, as an entrepreneur. So, you know, spending time in like, you know, like foreign countries and, you know, trying to understand how things work, you know, could be a huge benefit.
Actually, Kohei, that's really kind of why we're doing this series. Thank you very much. Thanks, everybody on the panel. This was a great session today. I'm really excited that, you know, we could be on location, you know, here in a co-location space where people are really trying out new things and starting new things here in Japan. This is real, right? It's not just somebody coming into a lecture room and you know, having beautifully made slides behind them and everything. I really appreciate our panel. If you would, everybody in the Stanford audience, please join me in thanking our panelists.